Welcome to Season 4 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Commissioner of Health in Baltimore City. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to current topics in public health through engaging interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, our topic is mental health, not just the impact of the pandemic on any one of us, but the impact of the pandemic on all of us. I'm speaking with Dr. Adam Karpati, the former Executive Deputy Commissioner for Mental Hygiene at the New York City Health Department. He's now the Senior Vice President at Vital Strategies. Let's listen. Adam Karpati, thank you so much for coming on to the podcast. This has been an incredibly stressful period for so many people, directly and indirectly dealing with the consequences of the pandemic. What does it all add up to in terms of the mental health challenges that we're facing?
Thanks very much for having me. I think the first thing to think about is that before the pandemic, mental health, mental illness was and continues to be a major public health challenge in the country. And a few points to make about this. First, mental illness is incredibly common. And I think that when we think about ourselves and our families and our communities, we recognize this intuitively. We know the burden of poor mental health. But just a few numbers on that. In any given year, something like 1 in 5 to 1 in 4 adults will report symptoms consistent with a mental illness. The most common ones, of course, are depression and anxiety disorders. So before the pandemic, mental illness was common. And we know that, unfortunately, many people don't get the help that they need struggling with mental health issues. The second point before the pandemic is that we know that social factors, poverty, racism, unemployment, etc., have significant influences on health and on mental health. And so with those two things in mind, the underlying high prevalence of mental illness, plus the strong influence of social factors on our health, and then we superimpose or we experience this pandemic on top of it, and the stress, the grief and loss, the trauma, the isolation of the pandemic, all those things together are contributing to increases and a greater burden of poor mental health and mental illness now.
And how is that manifested today? How do we see the signs of this wave of mental health challenges hitting us?
So when you think about what those influences were that I just mentioned, when you think about stress, and we can recognize that that's affecting so many people in so many different ways, whether that's the stress that we all are facing, the fears around the illness itself, but also the stress. And again, this is borne more heavily by people at lower socioeconomic status, the stress of job loss, the stress of the economic impacts of the public health and social measures. So we see it in terms of stress. We see the manifestations of grief and loss, people and their families and their communities. We also see the impact of trauma. And in addition to the pandemic, of course, there has been also the experience of the murder of George Floyd, the reckoning around racial injustice and racism in the country. This, again, superimposed, as I said before, on a historical, on a baseline of trauma. You put these together, and what people are experiencing are high levels of symptoms of depression, of low mood, of anxiety, of withdrawal and isolation, increases in substance use, whether it's alcohol or drugs, and many other forms of poor mental health. And we don't know to what degree these symptoms, these manifestations of poor mental health will continue on, will become more severe and long-lasting into mental illnesses. But we do know that there's a lot of need out there for people to get help.
certainly a drag on the recovery as the number of COVID cases come down. We have, you know, students, young people who are coping with these challenges, as well as people who are hoping to find jobs. Could imagine it may be contributing to increases in violence in different areas. You take a step back and you can really see the imprint of mental health challenges on a lot of the key areas that constitute recovery.
Absolutely. And I think you're right to start to highlight some of the particularly vulnerable populations, whether that's children, the elderly, healthcare workers who have been experiencing such direct interaction with loss and death and suffering, essential workers and all the stresses of the daily experience of trying to maintain work and go to work in the course of the pandemic. So important, I think it's very important to think about all those special populations and special cases, because they will all need different approaches and different strategies to help. And one other thing to mention is we talk about how there was a high prevalence of mental illness in the population before the pandemic. So we also have to think about those with the most serious mental illnesses. Those people dependent on or really in need of clinical services, of supportive services, and the disruptions to the care system, the disruptions to the social support services for people with the most severe mental illnesses has also been extremely substantial. And we also need to pay attention to rebuilding and strengthening those structures as well.
So let's talk about what it means to dig out of the situation that we're in right now. And I'm guessing you don't think the answer is just to close our eyes and pretend that it's 2019 again.
Obviously not. The range and the scale of the problem, as we've been discussing, really calls for a response at the same scale. And it needs to involve a number of different avenues. But what I would say in general is that it's about activating and engaging sort of a whole of community approach to mental health promotion and addressing mental illness. And what I mean by that is engaging all the different sectors and all the different institutions in our communities that can engage people, that can recognize when people are in need and provide support. And that has to happen on many different levels.
So states, localities are getting some extra money from the federal relief packages. What would be good uses of that money to improve mental health in their areas?
So at the community level, I think we really need to leverage all of those resources and institutions that interact with people, where there's opportunities to provide acknowledgement of the burden, of the stress that people are feeling, to provide supportive services where necessary, and to refer to clinical care when necessary. And by those institutions, that's schools, community organizations, faith organizations, these are our eyes and ears and also our mechanisms of support. They need the resources to be able to be proactive about addressing mental health challenges. Employers as well. There needs to be an acknowledgement and a recognition of the burden that people are facing, and then resources to do that kind of outreach and support.
And I hear you saying that it's just maybe not the case and not possible for every single person who's feeling stressed to have, you know, a full mental health clinical relationship with a psychiatrist, say. There aren't enough psychiatrists given how many people are suffering. So what do you do in that situation? How do you help people who are feeling so much stress, maybe some, you know, symptoms of depression and anxiety without a clinical relationship?
So I think this gets to really what some of the needs more generally are to strengthen our mental health system. And again, going back to the point that mental health challenges are so common in our society. We don't yet have the resources at the scale necessary. And you're right. The response needs to be appropriate to the need, and not every single person is going to require the highest level of need. So there's a few things we can do. There's great evidence from around the world that we can deliver mental health support services, very high quality services that really help people and change the trajectory of their mental health challenges, not with social workers and psychiatrists, but with community health workers. And those models are well proven and should be expanded and supported and resourced throughout the country. So more of those community engagement models is what we need. Telemedicine and telehealth is another strategy that has the potential. It was something that, I don't know, you call a silver lining perhaps in the pandemic, but it's a strategy that has the potential to really scale up the reach of our mental health system by increasing access and engagement. So telehealth, community-based solutions, computer-assisted or electronic methods, there's a lot of promising evidence that supportive and even treatment-oriented resources through computers, through the internet, can be very effective. And again, these tools have the potential to really expand the reach of our mental health system. You know, we need to be careful about those. We need to make sure that we use tools that are proven and that are based in science, but there's very promising areas there. And of course, our primary care system, the doctors, the nurses, the physician assistants that people know and trust are really the main providers of mental health care in the country, and they need to be supported. And there's a lot more that we can be doing there. So those are just some examples of how to scale up and really bring resources to where they're most needed.
In a way, you're saying that the pandemic gives a push to create the mental health system we've needed for a while.
I think that's exactly right. We talk about our mental health system, but in many ways, it's not a system. It's not a system yet. It's quite fragmented. There's a lot of great providers. There's a lot of great resources. But too often, people fall through the cracks, either because they are not identified and supported into care, or when they're in care, there's too many opportunities to get lost. And that's unfortunately the case. And for those with the highest needs, the most serious cases of mental illness, we haven't yet realized the promise of deinstitutionalization. The promise of deinstitutionalization was community-based support, was the ability to get care and services in communities, not in institutions. And we're not there yet. There are some building blocks. And I think that some of the opportunities coming out of the pandemic are to reimagine and rethink the way we deliver community-based care. But it gets back to having the resources.
One of the dimensions of mental health, challenges of mental illness, is that it can be so isolating. People, you know, because they're depressed, they feel like, you know, they're on their own. They don't see the fact that many other people are depressed. People who are anxious may stay away from other people, and so they're on their own too. And so you have, unlike some other conditions, maybe where people might come together and, you know, advocate together for changes, or, you know, it creates this paradox of many people experiencing similar things, but, you know, apart from each other. How do you overcome that as you're rethinking the mental health system?
I think it gets to this point about being proactive and making sure that we engage those institutions that have the connections, that have the trust, to be able to do that proactive outreach and engagement.
Well, what about the role of leaders, mayors, governors, elected officials in helping people get the services that they need?
I think that's extremely important. And obviously, it starts with political leadership acknowledging and destigmatizing people getting help. The first step to combating the isolation that you describe is overcoming the stigma that's associated with seeking help for mental health, for mental illness. And so that's where political leadership can be very strong, obviously, in naming it, in normalizing care seeking, and of course, in strengthening the systems and investing in that kind of community engagement and community support. It also can take the form of some very much more specific interventions or strategies. For example, strengthening community supports and community-based models for mental health means changing our crisis intervention model. Too often, people with mental illness who are in crisis end up interacting mainly with the criminal justice system, with the law enforcement. And we know there's been some tragic examples of those interactions, like, you know, Daniel Prude in New York and many others. So that is an opportunity, I think, where leaders can say, we need a new approach to crisis that shifts the focus from law enforcement to public health.
Sounds like this is a pivotal moment on mental health along a few different dimensions. Are you optimistic we'll see the kinds of changes that you're talking about?
I think that the building blocks are there. There's good evidence-based strategies. There's been a lot of awareness of these issues in the professional communities and advocacy communities. I think it's starting to now be recognized in the larger political conversation. And so it's an opportunity, of course. I think the building blocks are there. We know what works, and it's about bringing it to scale with the appropriate resources. And so I think in that sense, we can have some optimism that we can envision this better situation, and we'll see if we can get there.
Adam Karpati, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thanks very much for having me.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outland. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holz Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.